Do you know what I see in young women as one of the greatest needs they have? They want someone to mother them in the faith. Can you mother somebody in the faith? Because if you want to see something that is missing, because they may have a natural mom, but they're looking that they love, that they wouldn't trade for anything. I did. But I also needed a mother in the faith. She taught me not only how to be in ministry, she taught me how to be a woman in ministry. I was not trained to act like a man in women's ministry. I was very much trained up to be a woman in women's ministry. I needed that. Mother some people. Mother some people. Sometimes all they need from you is this, can you hug them? Can you hug them? That's sometimes all they're asking is, man, I could really, really use an unconditional hug. Go with me to Revelation 22, and I want to show you something. This is under our category of fellow servants. Revelation 22, something really crazy happens here. So John is receiving this word from this angel who is speaking to him. And it says, I'm going to pick up Revelation 22. You can obviously see that this is the very last chapter of Scripture. So it's so interesting, especially that it's here. And verse 6 is where I want you to pick up, 22:6. I'm going to read through 9. It says this, then he said to me, these words are faithful and true. The Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, has sent his angel to show his servants what must soon take place. And then he quotes Jesus, look, I am coming soon. Blessed is the one who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book. And he says in verse 8, I, John, and this is John the beloved disciple, I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. And when I heard and saw them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who had shown them to me. But he said to me, don't do that. I am a fellow servant with you. Your brothers, the prophets, and those who keep the words of this book, worship God. Don't do that. Listen, this was an angel, a mighty angel going, do not worship me. Let me tell you why this is so important. Because what can happen with fellow sojourners is that the leader can become, there can become some entitlement in that leader, and there can become some obedience of the group of sojourners to the leader. That is not what we're talking about. Fellow sojourners are shoulder to shoulder pursuing obedience to Christ, not just loyalty to a leader. I don't want blind loyalty from my staff. I do not want it. I think it's one of the most dangerous things in the world when we would stand with any leader, no matter what, and protect them and guard them, no matter what they have done behind the scenes. That's not healthy. That's not fellow sojourners. Fellow sojourners don't have one person that is always the focus. One of the things I see in a lot of the small group dynamics, so there'll be lots of small group Bible studies, and they'll meet maybe every week, and maybe there's 8 of them. For one thing, I start getting worried when they said the same group of 8 of us have been together for 10 years. Well, then I'm all like, somebody needs to get a new group. Because something's happened there where nobody's changing. Is what was this, TikTok, the game's locked, nobody else can play? Is that what we're doing here? Because I don't know. That doesn't feel healthy to me. A community of believers is a living organism. That edge, that circle changes. It's moving continually. I'm all about a group getting together, and that same group sees that study through. But when we've been through 8 years of study together, and it's still the same 8 of us, I don't know, something's up. Anybody agree with that? Maybe I'm weird. But I'm a little bit, that kind of worries me a little bit. But I can also tell you another dynamic that happens. One person can suck up every bit of the attention in the group, and they just keep getting it for years on end. Because it's their dynamic. Their small group is there for them. And they never get out of a crisis. Well, of course they don't. Because the crisis is working for them. Because the crisis is now attracting all the attention of the group. And so they go to get their group therapy. Not what we're talking about. If we're going to get group therapy, go to group therapy. I believe in therapy. Anybody else believe in therapy? I believe in therapy. These are fellow traveling companions in the faith. And healthy traveling companions know whose turn it is to get a whole lot of extra attention because they are in dire need. For us at Living Proof, it changes continually. I mean, there will always be several of us that are in the biggest crisis among us. And it's the others' turn to kind of step back a little bit, and these are the ones we are all really in it over. Anybody know what I'm talking about? This is how we want that group thing to go. Nobody gets worshiped. We are fellow servants. If there were an angel among us, still that angel would be able to say to us, "Don't you dare worship me. You worship God only." All right, now look at Philippians 2:25. So we've got the best kind of traveling companions in the walk of faith. What was the first set? Tell me again. Fellow servants. All right, now look at Philippians 2:25. This is another one. Philippians 2:25, but I considered it, this is Paul talking, but I considered it necessary to send you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier, as your messenger and minister to my need. If we want fellow sojourners, if we are looking for traveling companions, what is it we want them to look like? Well, we want some fellow servants. We also want some fellow soldiers. Fellow soldiers. Now let's talk about what a fellow soldier means. It's a wonderful, wonderful word. You once again see that S-U on the front of that Greek word that when it is in a compound word, it's going to mean together or with. It is a word, the word you would say sistratiotes. It is a word that means fellow soldier, figuratively of Christian teachers, Paul's companions, in the labors and dangers of Christian warfare. The labors and dangers of Christian warfare. Listen, this one is so important because here's what I'm going to tell you. Now, there's no condemnation, zero, zero, zero condemnation. So do not take it from what I'm about to say. But I do want to speak seriously to you about this because if you are really doing the thing, I can tell you this. You are having a hard time doing it by yourself because this thing is a fury. I mean, we live in such a hostile world. And we have real life powers and principalities that keep the darkness closing in on this globe. And I'm just saying, if we're serious about the things of the faith, we're always dealing with some element of spiritual warfare that is real. And one of the things we need in our fellow sojourners is we need somebody that will fight with us and fight for us. And by with us, I mean alongside. Sometimes we may have to fight with one another to fight for one another. If that's necessary, then we work through that conflict. But fellow soldiers, who do you have, your fellow fighters? Who in your life, I asked you earlier at the very beginning of our series, I ask you, who in your life do you know would pray over you? Who in your life would speak things over you like, listen, in Jesus' name, I pray that no weapon forged against you will prosper. In Jesus' name, you can know that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things future, nor things past, nor things present, nothing in this world can separate you from the love of Christ. In Jesus' name, I can tell you, God is for you. And if God is for you, who can be against you? I got to know those things. Who's going to do that for you? Because you need people in the faith that can say to you, I got to tell you in Jesus' name, perfect love casts out fear. Who's going to do that? Who fights for you? We got this little motion we do at Living Proof. We've just done it for years and years and years. When we know that the enemy is coming after one of our cohorts, one of our fellow sojourners, there's just one. I mean, all we have to do is one little motion, and it's like this. Whew. I mean, just pull out your sword because we are about to fight. I cannot begin to tell you the battles we have fought together. I say this with reverence. I say this with fear before the Lord. I am not trying to tempt the enemy, but I'm just going to simply say some of us have been together for 25 years and he has not killed us yet. Oh, I need more from you than that. Because I need you to know that he has tried to. I need you to know that he has tried to take us down over and over and over and divide us and split us up, divide and conquer over and over again. And I'm not trying to tempt the darkness here. I am simply saying in Jesus' name, he has not been successful. He has not been successful. Who fights for you? You got to have it. I got to have fellow soldiers who are going to fight for me. Listen, I love this. Another definition. So in another Greek dictionary, another way to translate into English, the Greek word, sistratiotes, is fellow struggler. Listen, if you're thinking, well, I'm just really struggling, then you know what? You're already saying that you're working hard. Because if you were just being defeated, you would not be struggling. Oh, I need somebody to get that word with me. Are you struggling right now in your faith? Well, then, listen, you're fighting. Because otherwise, you just be like laid down. Like shipwrecked. You struggling? Well, good. That's a good sign. That's a sign of life. That's, you know, I'm hanging on for dear life. I feel like I'm hanging on by a thread. Let me tell you something. If you're hanging on to Jesus, you are never hanging on by a thread. Not ever. You are hanging on to the rope that is attached to an anchor behind the veil. And he will never let go of you. Not ever let go of you. Who will remind you that Jesus will never let you go? You better have somebody. You better have some people in the faith. I need somebody to say amen.
In this interesting time, when we feel distant,
God is not.
We may feel alone,
but he is near.
We know you have a lot that concerns you. Worry, perhaps fear for your job, sadness, the loss of a loved one.
But we want you to know that the God of all the universe loves you. He wants to comfort you with his word and spend time with you.
You might be thinking, how do you spend time with God?
Start simple. Living Proof wants to encourage you to read God's word every day. We believe it will change your life.
We have a resource to help you engage God through his word. It's a daily devotional from Beth's personal reflection on the lives of Jesus, David, John, and Paul.
It will help guide you. It's something to bring your focus to the giver of hope.
Are you listening?
He's speaking.
Living Proof Ministries is so pleased to partner with the Voice of the Martyrs as they teach us how to come alongside our persecuted brothers and sisters who serve Jesus in areas of the world closed to the gospel. I love the Voice of the Martyrs' core ministry verse. It's out of Hebrews 13. Remember those who are in prison as though in prison with them. Part of the Voice of the Martyrs' mission is to call the body of Christ to remember our persecuted Christian family members by fervently praying and providing support for them. Today, as a blessing to you, the Voice of the Martyrs will send you a free copy of their book, Hearts of Fire, when you visit their website. You will be impacted by 8 women in the underground church and their stories of costly faith. Would you join me in linking arms with the Voice of the Martyrs to further the gospel? We would be so grateful.
I gotta tell you, we have all been through a lot in the last years, but I have never in my life, I say to you, I have never had more confidence in the pure gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Oh, my soul, lift up the name of the one who saves. He reigns forever. Oh, my soul, lift up your praise. I will rise and bless the Lord. Oh, my soul, oh, my soul, oh, my soul, oh, my soul.
Let me tell you something. He's come to speak in power to us this weekend because his word is fresh and alive. That's the miracle of the scriptures.
Come join us in a city near you.
I want you to look with me lastly at Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. There is no more beautiful sound in this entire world than the sound of Bible pages turning. I love it so much. I got to tell you, I love that sound in here because I love electronic Bibles. I really, really do. But I mean, it is hard when you are in a crisis to hold your iPad to your chest and really feel, you know what I'm talking about? It's so awkward. It won't fold in, you know, it's just something like, I don't know, I just don't feel the same about it. I love it. I use one every day, but I don't know, it just does not bring out the same affection in me. All right, this wonderful, wonderful moment in 8 through 10. So Luke 15, 8 through 10. This one, I'm gonna have to make a noun out of a verb for it to go with what we've done so far. This is the last of the three. When we're looking for what do we want in our traveling companions? Well, we want, what was the first one? Fellow servants. And then what was the second one? We want some fellow soldiers. Now, we're wanting these to be the same people. This is how we'll know these are our traveling companions. And we're going to pray these up. And let me tell you something. We're not only going to pray them up, we have to become these. Oh, can somebody go there with me? We have to become these so that we are these for other people. But so the last one, we're going to see in the verb form, but we're going to make a noun out of it. It says in verse 8, or what woman who has 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, because I have found the silver coin I lost. I tell you, in the same way, there is joy in the presence of God's angels over one sinner who repents. That is gorgeous, gorgeous. When it says she calls her friends, in Greek it is the word philos, P-H-I-L-A-S. It's the feminine form of P-H-I-L-O-S, which is the masculine for friends. In other words, she is talking about her girlfriends. It's such a glorious thing. But what we're seeing here, I thought I was making up this word, but I'm going to prove to you I'm not making it up. In this third little category of what we want in our fellow traveling companions, it is fellow rejoicers. Fellow rejoicers. Now you might go, is rejoicer even a word? Yes, and you know how I know? Because I looked to the only reliable source. I looked to Scrabble. And I said, is rejoicer a Scrabble word? And it says, and I have it on the screen before you, yes, the word rejoicer is a Scrabble U.S. word. The word rejoicer is worth 17 points in Scrabble. Is rejoicer a word? Yes, it is a 17-point word. You better believe it is legit. Rejoice with me is what it means. You see that Greek word, the S-U, again, meaning together with. Caro, meaning to rejoice, to share one another's joys. I just love the fact that the antonym of it means to sorrow or to be grieved with someone. To sorrow or to be grieved with someone. To have the capacity. Remember when I asked you in the very, very first of the series, who do you laugh with? Who do you cry with? Do those overlap at all? Because what a beautiful thing. And it doesn't mean every one of your traveling companions have to be people you can always laugh and cry with, but man, it sure is nice. Man, it sure is nice. We better be comfortable with doing it. We better be comfortable that we could have some tears with them. It's this most gorgeous place. I want to give you this picture at the end of this lesson. There's this place at the very end of Acts 5. It almost makes me cry to read it. John and Peter have had the snot beaten out of them for proclaiming the name of Jesus. That Jesus is Messiah, and he's come fulfilling all of those Old Testament prophecies. Well, they're called into the Sanhedrin. They are threatened and threatened. Do not use it again. Well, they go out and immediately do it again. And they just go through all sorts of imprisonments, all sorts of punishments and beatings, persecutions. But it says this gorgeous thing about them in 38 through 42. It says, so in this present case, This is the word of counsel given to the Sanhedrin. I tell you, stay away from these men and leave them alone. For if this plan or this work is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. You may be found fighting against God. So they were persuaded by them. So after they called in the apostles and had them flogged, y'all, this would not be fun to be flogged. Just because it is in Scripture does not mean that somehow when they got beaten with rods, it did not hurt. It bloodied them and bruised them. And they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and released them. 41. They went out from the presence of the Sanhedrin, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to be treated shamefully on behalf of the name. And then every day in the temple and in various homes, they continued teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Messiah. What do you do with that? I want to say something to you. This is our heritage of faith. This is our bloodline. We come from courageous people that go, I got a chance to be misused because I proclaimed the name of Jesus. You know one thing that gave them the courage? Having one another. And it multiplied their joys. They were like, high five. Look what happened to us. I'll tell you a story as we close. A couple of days ago, I was on a plane coming back from Dallas. And I was on a fairly, one of the smaller planes, but it still had a little first class area. And please just forgive me if this is offensive to anyone, but you got to understand something. I have flown 10 jillion miles, and I'm old. And at this point, I got a lot of upgrades. Anybody know what I'm talking about? A lot of upgrades. So I was in seat 2B coming back from Dallas, and there was a young man, I'm going to guess that he was about 13, that was in 1A. So he was in the bulkhead. He was in the very front seat of it, and he was closest to the window. And I'm just going to tell you something. There is no way that kid had ever flown before, because I have never seen anyone that excited about flying in all of my life. And he wasn't with anyone that he wasn't sitting beside anyone that he knew, and there was no one on the plane that I think he had any connection to. And he was so thrilled about the whole thing. He was thrilled from the time that we had to put on our seatbelts. When we started rolling down the tarmac, he was like looking around going like. When we took off on the plane, he was like. And he just kept looking around for someone to get excited with him. And he looked over there and he looked at the guy next to him, stone face, straight ahead. So, you know, he looks back behind him. Well, you know what I've got to do. I'm like, yes, yes. Later on in the plane ride, he gets up and he goes and he says, and he looks at me because I'm the only one that will make eye contact with him. And he said, can I go to the bathroom? And I said, yes. See that little green sign up there? That means that you can go to the bathroom. And that green sign means no one's in it. And so he says, where is it? And I said, it's right there, right in front of you. Go right there in front of you. I mean, like, who tells you where you can go to the bathroom? Because you got to have somebody. And let me tell you something, he made my whole trip, because it was just like, it was so thrilling to him that it was thrilling to me. It was like, man, we have been on a ride together, buddy. I don't even know his name, but we were traveling companions. You don't want to miss that for the world. So I want you to stand to your feet. Let's press in and pray for this. You'll get a little bit of insight from the pop quiz I gave you at the very beginning of the series. Because I asked you a series of questions. Who is it that you call? Who is it that you know is going to stay with you? Who is it that would fight for you? Start praying for that. And start being willing to get outside your own age group and your type, your color and your background. You may even find that somebody of a different denomination is saved. You're just not even going to believe it. These people are saved. We have one another, and Man, we're just like in it together, and we're on this little text group and can say, man, I have a test. I have a test today, and I need you to stand with me in it. We pray for a young woman with her college exams. Some of my friends I prayed with about their kids when they were in the first grade. Praying for one another. I'm having a mammogram tomorrow, and I'm nervous about it. Who can we trust with information like, I don't know what's happening in my marriage? Who listens without telling everything? Oh, we got to have it, girls.
Living Proof would like to send you a thank you gift for your donation. Visit bethmore.org/donate.
Thank you so much for watching today. It is our joy to serve you at Living Proof Ministries. We do not take a single one of you for granted. Click subscribe so that you don't miss a moment of our time together in Scripture.